markets. ADB, for example, putting Philippine GDP forecasts tied with Vietnam as highest and fastest in Southeast Asia, above the region's 5% estimate. But I think you're not too convinced, are you, by these big numbers?
Well, I think I'm also quite, cautiously optimistic about the economic growth this year. Mm-hmm. I think 6 to 6.5% is achievable mm-hmm. this year. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Mm-hmm. But you want to focus on the lens of quality versus quantity. The numbers, the headline numbers are not enough.
That's right. You know, if we are single-minded about quantity economic growth, meaning just the volume, the rate of economic growth per se, then build or the infrastructure program is really the best way to push our economic growth to high levels. But then that shouldn't be the priority these days for the Philippines. Because we have so many problems. We have a problem. We have education is in crisis. Health care is in crisis. There are a number of things that need to be having to do with human development. Mm-hmm. I am more concerned about human development. At least I think that is the primordial, that should be the primordial concern of the government and of Philippine society. Because we want our people to be able to realize their full potential, but we have this crisis, and I think we should address the health and education crisis as well as the food and nutrition crisis. These are the most crucial, the most demanding requirements that we should address, and we can do this if the first priority is really to focus on addressing the education, health crisis, and nutrition crisis in our country. Mm-hmm. And also, so as I've said, this has to do with human development, and also early child development is important. Because as you know, one third of children 0 to 5 are stunted. They are stunted, and so how do we expect them to be productive in the future? Mm-hmm. So these things have to be addressed. Mm-hmm. At the same time, we could also do something about physical infrastructure, but that can be done by the private sector through public-private partnership programs, mm-hmm. as well as official development assistance from Japan, from Korea, from the U.S., from EU countries.
Mm-hmm. You missed one country for the ODA, China. What about China? But Secretary, before we get to China, I want to, you said a lot of things there. I want to break that down. You did say it's about human development. It's about empowering every Filipino to reach their full potential. You said it's about addressing the education crisis, the healthcare crisis, food security. But these sound very long-term. These are issues, you know, that you can't solve in 1 year, let alone 6 years, one term of the president. How should this administration begin solving these issues? Are there low-hanging fruits? Are there certain things they can start today to plant the seed so these things are addressed down the road?
Well, these critical issues have not been addressed by previous governments, previous administrations. And for example, if we do something about those in basic education, K to 12, in 6 years, many of them will be in college, and even some will be going to graduate school. And so, of course, primary education will be longer distance into the future, but basic education, K to 12, is important, mm-hmm. and at the K to 12 level, we should really emphasize the STEM, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, mm-hmm. so for them to be able to do well in college, mm-hmm. as well as in graduate school.
Mm-hmm. Secretary, you know, we're just coming from, you know, over the weekend, the World Bank actually released some sad data calling the Philippines as one of the East Asian Pacific's, having one of East Asian Pacific's highest learning poverty rates. They're saying 9 out of 10 Filipino children aged 10 are struggling to read simple texts.
Yes, that's the learning problem, learning poverty. Mm-hmm. And that is very telling. Mm-hmm. That is very telling. If that is the case, then even after 6 years, after 6 years, many of those in at 10 years old now will be 16 years old, and so they should be ready for going into higher education. Mm-hmm. And many of our problems really have to do with our population is just growing too fast. Mm-hmm. We have the largest population size in ASEAN vis-a-vis a land area, which proxies for resource base, okay? At the same time, we have the highest poverty incidence. So we cannot continue to neglect this as you said, long-term issues. We have to start doing something about these long-term issues. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, we will continue to be, a bottom dweller in terms of our ASEAN, in terms of ASEAN gathering, ASEAN organization.
Secretary, poverty rate as of the first half of last year was at 23.7. That's higher than 2018's at 21.1. I know that you were hoping to bring this down to the teens, but the pandemic happened. So we're at 23.7. President Marcos says he's targeting to cut that to 9% by the time he steps down in 6 years. Is that realistic? Is that feasible?
Realistic if, many of the things we have mentioned, we have discussed just now, are going to be addressed. Because, the population growth is 1.5 million per annum, okay? So in 6 years, there will be an additional 9 million Filipinos. And if we are not, and many of these belong to the poverty sector, and so poverty will just expand to a higher level. Mm-hmm. It will be difficult to bring it down to 9% as aimed by this Marcos administration. Mm-hmm.
And we've got, we've got unemployment rate 6% in May. That's a 3-month high. Beyond the number of 6%, it's also about the quality of jobs, the quality of work that we are able to give Filipinos. How would you rate the quality of employment that we have today?
Well, the quality of employment can be improved, mm-hmm. because we have a lot of underemployment. It's not just unemployment that we should be looking at. Underemployment is even more important, because underemployment is anybody working for 1 hour the previous week, mm-hmm. is considered employed.
Yeah.
But 1 hour working a week is, or not one day a week is nothing. Yeah. It's nothing. It's underemployment that we should be really focusing on.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. All right. Secretary, I want to go back to your thoughts on the PPP. You touched on this earlier. There's renewed calls to focus on PPPs. Let the private sector play a bigger role because government has its finances tied up for now. Over the last couple of weeks, there was big news about Beijing, their funding commitment for 3 railway projects, the Calamba-Bicol, the Clark-Subic, and Mindanao railway projects deemed canceled because, according to Philippine transport officials, Beijing has been unresponsive to our loan application since 2019. Number one, do you consider this as a failure on our part, or is it the Philippines dodging a bullet?
No, I think China is just dribbling the ball. And that's because of the quid pro quo policy of China.
Mm-hmm.
They are willing to give us something, but they need something in return. Like, for example, we should not be making noise anymore about the about the arbitral tribunal on the West Philippine Sea.
Mm-hmm.
And so that is the thing. That is the elephant in the room as far as the China is concerned. They don't want us to continue to talk about our claim to the parts of the West Philippine Sea or the South China Sea. Mm-hmm. And to silence us, they are trying to give us, well, they promised something like 20 projects in 2016 when we went there, a total of $9 billion. Mm-hmm. But so far, they've only given us $600 million for, I think, mainly for the Chico River irrigation project in Cagayan up north. Mm-hmm. That's the only one that has really been that has been funded and already practically finished already. Mm-hmm. The next one is the Kaliwa Dam, but the Kaliwa Dam is in some kind of trouble because the IPs there are protesting. Mm-hmm. And it's not so easy a project to finish.
So this news, how should Filipinos take this news? Is this good news or bad news for the Philippines?
If I were asked, mm-hmm. I would just drop ODA from China. You know, Vietnam doesn't get ODA from China, but Vietnam gets Vietnam is able to get foreign direct investment from China. So why can't we follow the Vietnam modality? Mm-hmm. Not ODA, but FDI from China.
Okay. I imagine that would be one of the big lessons this new administration can take from this experience. And
yes.
How it approaches, China ODAs and big ticket projects in general.
Right. Mm-hmm. And, PPP, Madame Michelle, is not just infrastructure projects. PPPs can also be done in social infrastructure, like hospitals, school buildings that are better equipped for children, and as well as other soft projects that can be done with the cooperation of the private sector. Mm-hmm. Essentially, I would want the private sector to be strange bedfellows with the public sector. Strange in the sense that there should be no hanky-panky. They are very close, very amicable between the two of them, but there should be no hanky-panky, mm-hmm. no corruption among agencies of the government vis-a-vis sectors in the private sector. Mm-hmm. So in other words, there should be cooperation for the economy, for society, for the betterment of people between the public sector and the private sector. Mm-hmm.
And speaking of strange bedfellows, close relationships between government and the private sector, big news over the weekend is Dennis Uy, a close ally, supporter of the former President Rodrigo Duterte, who advanced and was propelled, in the last 6 years, really making it big splash here in Metro Manila, on the global stage even. He went on a debt-fueled investment binge and now facing supposedly creditor troubles. Do you think that, he's one of those poster boys of business, how business did, especially businesses who are close to Mr. Duterte, supposedly how they did in the last 6 years, but now with trouble brewing with his creditors, is he considered a too big to fail personality already? How would you view this story?
Well, that is unfortunate. There was a lot of adversarial relationship between the government and the private sector during the Duterte administration. President Duterte, for example, blasted Manila Water and Maynilad.
Yes, Mr. Ong Pien.
That's right.
This news channel as well, the parent of this news channel as well.
At the same time, there was some bedfellow kind of relationship between between some of those in government or friends of the president and the private sector. Mm-hmm. So, that's foul. Mm-hmm. That shouldn't be allowed. with a president that is that has integrity and vision for society, not for, you know, cronies.
Definitely a space we're going to watch. Speaking of vision, and this is where I want to end, Secretary Purnia, you know, it's all about long-term vision for countries, you know, targets that stretch beyond just one man's six-year term as president. What do you think is the Philippines' long-term vision? I mean, you think about Vietnam, and you know everything that they do is grooming themselves to become a manufacturing hub, a manufacturing powerhouse, an FDI powerhouse. You think about South Korea, like Japan, it's a high-tech country. What about the Philippines? What should we be known for? What should we strive for?
I think we can still strive for improving agriculture and manufacturing also. And at the same time, science and technology and innovation.
Manufacturing, all right.
Science, technology and innovation. We should be ahead of the others, but we are not, because we have not invested enough in science and technology. We are at the bottom in terms of spending on science and technology and innovation among our ASEAN peers.
Because Secretary, right now we are viewed as one of the top exporters of talent. Is that actually a good thing?
Exporters of talent. We have several high-level scientists and engineers in the U.S. and in other countries, and they are collaborating with us. And many of them would want to come back if the policies of the government are more friendly, are more welcoming to them. So why don't we do that? You know, it's hard for a Filipino, an American, a Filipino who's in the U.S., Filipino American, to get an teaching item, a regular teaching item in the university. I don't know why, because in China, it's very easy for Americans to get a teaching item in the university. In Malaysia, it is. In Singapore, in Thailand. But in the Philippines, even a dual citizen, I am told, cannot easily get a regular teaching item, UP, for example. I don't know why. Let us open up. Let us open up the economy. Let us open up education.
All right. And on that note, sir, thank you very much for your insights this morning, for your thoughts, and for the time. Secretary Purnia, always a pleasure speaking with you, sir.
Thank you, Michelle. And I'm delighted that you've invited me to your program.
All right. We'll see you soon.
Thank you.
All right. Do stay.